shit goes down, no matter if you like have disagreements or arguments or whatever, you end up finding yourself back in that same space. Because when the real fights go down, you know which side people are on. And one of those people that has always been on the right side in whatever fight it might be, a man that I've known for a long time, fighting for human rights in this country, never did I dream that he would be the next arranged marriage of Jill Stein's. But quite frankly, I couldn't have thought of anybody else that would have been any better. So I'm proud to announce and introduce you to our next Vice President of our country.
Thank you, Sherry. Thank you for that lovely intro. Thank all of you for coming out this afternoon. It is indeed a pleasure and an honor to be here sharing this space with you. You know, I'm not going to say much this afternoon. You know, a few days ago, Dr. Stein and I, in Atlanta, I talked for an hour and 15 minutes. But that was necessary because we had folks that were coming and wanted to know about the Green Party. They weren't necessarily our activists on our side, but they wanted to understand. So it was necessary to have a conversation. And after we talked for an hour and 15 minutes, we had another 2 hours of Q&A. And it was very, very, interesting, and I think very successful. Because we have people in that audience that said, and you know what? Now I understand. Now I understand what the historical task is. Now I understand the importance of the Green Party and this campaign.
Amen.
So, we don't need to do that this afternoon. But what I want to talk about, though, is something a little bit more personal in the sense, you know, we have, how many days now? About 4 days ago? 3 days. It's been a fantastic experience. I want to thank Dr. Stein and the Green Party for giving me this opportunity to get a chance to move across this country and to talk with and get to know folks like yourself. Because you are on the front line. You all understand what we need to do. You all understand that we are in fact the future. This party is in fact the future. And so while I understood that also intuitively, having a chance to move across this country and to talk with and meet people and hear their stories, it deepened my commitment and even grounded me even more in the importance of this mission. People tell us all the time that we have to go forward because they recognize that they are living at a time in history where they don't know what's going to happen. They've been told that things are getting better for them. But they tell us that their lived experiences tell them something different. And even though they are living a contradiction, they are in fact suffering, they tell us we have to keep on struggling and fighting because no one seems to be telling their story. So they say, Ajamu, we understand. Keep on fighting. Keep on organizing. Tell people out there as you move around this country that things aren't what the two major parties are saying. Things aren't as good as Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton are trying to tell us.
That's right.
Things are bad and no one is talking to them. Now, what they also say is that we understand though why on the other side there are people who are angry. There are people who are upset. There are people who have come to the conclusion that instead of the system being an explanation for why they're suffering, that they are in fact looking at us, the other sufferers. Because on the other side, no one has been talking to them about their anger. No one's been talking to them about the condition that they're facing until Donald Trump came along. And he began to give them voice. He began to amplify their sufferings. Now, it was a distorted analysis, of course, he brought, but at least someone they felt was speaking to their needs. On the other side, all we are getting is basically the promises of things to remain as they are. We've been told by the Democrats and Hillary Clinton campaign that in essence, she's going to be a third term of Barack Obama.
Wow.
And the people are saying if that in fact is a possibility, then we need to join the Green Party and fight because we can't have more of this. Came to understand better as I move across this country is how sophisticated people are. You know, there's this myth out there that folks are just completely malleable, that they don't understand the world, that they are just being pointed in certain directions and being told to vote a certain way, and they do that. Now, granted, there are many people who, in fact, are like that. But what I came to understand is that there are a lot of people who are trying to understand. There are a lot of people who have been thinking and have critical questions. The problem has been that very few times have they had a chance to be able to tell those stories and to offer their analysis. And now that they are beginning to see that there is in fact a new structure, because as many as people never heard of the Green Party. But as we are taking this Green Party to people across this country, now they are saying they have a structure, they have a platform, they have some place to go to tell their stories and to deepen their understanding, deepen their analysis. And that's why we're seeing more and more people coming closer to us. You know, in this country, this so-called democracy, when you do have these third-party challenges, by October, you normally see it begin at the beginning of sort of a losing of some steam for that third party. As you get closer to the time to cast your vote, people begin to get themselves ready to hold their nose and vote for the lesser of two evils. But this time around, we've been talking about this, there's something different that not only have our support been steady, it's been increasing. And even though in the major polls, they have been trying to keep us at a certain level.
That's right.
We start to creep up in the major polls.
That's right.
Recognize that even the major polls are not really capturing what's really out there. Now we understand that there's some real issues with the methodology. You know, they're calling people on landlines. we know that we have a huge sector among young people that aren't being tapped and aren't being measured. We're moving around this country and we can feel the momentum. Okay? We can feel the connection. So we know that there's something out there. So we know that on November the 8th, there's going to be, in fact, a surprise in this country. Because for something new. And like what Chris Hedges and everybody said already, there are millions and millions of people now who are ready to step forward, who have the courage to say that we are prepared to take a chance. We are prepared to build something new. We are prepared to, in fact, to fight for revolutionary change. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. So this experience for me has deepened my commitment, deepened my understanding of what we need to do, grounded me even more in my dedication to building an alternative, an authentic alternative power in this country, and deepened my understanding also that we are in fact going to win. Now, part of the reason I think that we are getting more momentum in our campaign, coming toward our campaign, is that one of the major issues that we are seeing all the time now, one of the concerns that people are having, is that now people are recognizing that not only might we have a continuation of neoliberal capitalist politics and economics under Hillary Clinton, but what they have also recognized is that under a possible Hillary Clinton administration, we're going to have the continuation of a strategy of permanent war.
That's right.
And people are turning away from that.
That's right.
So we are being told that people are going to vote for us to demonstrate their opposition to war, to demonstrate their commitment to peace.
That's right.
They are telling us that instead of holding their nose and voting for the lesser of two evils, they understand now that they can vote for something, that they can vote for peace, they can vote for social justice, they can vote for racial justice, they can vote for a new value system. They understand they have a choice today. So my friends, this task we have before us is in fact a historic task. We talk all the time about the fact that it's not just about the vote on Tuesday. We want people to vote for us. We want to be prepared to be able to be in a stronger place to contest. But we also say over and over again that this is about building a real alternative revolutionary process. And when you recognize that that in fact is a historical task, then you understand that we have facing us a protracted struggle. That our responsibility is to go beyond November the 8th and to be a part of building this alternative structure. So it means getting involved in the great party apparatuses
That's
across
right.
this country.
That's right.
It means that if you don't participate in the great party apparatus, that you join some organization.
That's right.
It means that you tell your neighbors and your friends that they have a responsibility to be active participants in this movement.
That's right.
It means standing shoulder to shoulder with young folks who are in motion.
That's right.
It means digging down deep and looking at your own stuff to prepare yourself to be a better and more effective revolutionary agent. These are the kind of things that we all have to do because we have this historical responsibility. Because as people also said before too, we have to struggle in this country because the leaders of this country the ones that control this state, the decisions they make not only impact us, but they impact the world. And so we have a historic responsibility not only to ourselves, but to the globe, to the struggling and oppressed people around the world. And we have to tell that story also. You see, one of the shortcomings, one of the contradictions of the struggle that took place within the Democratic Party was that there was very little conversation around what kinds of politics and policies and positions a progressive administration would take vis-a-vis the rest of the world. It became too U.S.-centric. And many of us criticized that and said that if you're going to be truly progressive or radical or revolutionary, you have to have an international perspective. You have to recognize that you couldn't pretend to say that you stand with and understand the importance and value of black lives in the U.S., but be solid with black people, brown people being destroyed, bombed, and killed by U.S. bombs and policies around the world. It's a contradiction. So we have to tell people that basically you have to question Hillary Clinton, who claims that she understands the importance of black lives, when it comes out in the WikiLeaks, that she recognizes that if she attempts to try to establish a no-fly zone in northern Syria, she says very clearly, they recognize that thousands of innocent people in Syria are going to die. So these are people of color. Well, these are human beings also. You can't say you understand humanity and the value of life when you can engage in that kind of reckless decision making.
That's right.
It reminds me. You can't say that you're concerned about women and working class women, and as Yannick pointed out, support policies in places like Haiti, where you have a largely labor market, workers who are primarily women,
right,
who are being super exploited.
That's right.
And you are supporting those kinds of policies.
That's right.
You can't say you're concerned about non-European life when you are involved in decision making in places like Honduras, where terror is unleashed as a consequence of you giving the green light to a coup in Honduras.
That's right.
Can't pretend that you understand humanity and life when you give a green light, participate in, and support the slaughter that took place in Libya with 50,000 people losing their lives. So these are the kinds of conversations we have to have with folks. Because for us, in particular, those of us who are members of oppressed communities, of people, for us, it doesn't really matter who wins this election. Because if Donald Trump wins, we have to struggle.
That's right.
If Hillary Clinton wins, we have to struggle.
That's right.
The only question comes, where will our allies be? And it seems to us that if history is a guide, we saw that under the Obama administration, as folks were being murdered by killer cops, as invasions were taking place in Libya, as the African command was being expanded across the African continent, as the war in Syria was expanding, as Iraq was reinvaded, as our schools were being closed down across this country, that basically there's no opposition, that the only ones that are left to resist are just a small amount of us who understand that we in fact have to resist. So the question comes to us, and it seems apparent to us, that if you believe in the protective arm of the Democratic Party, that all we have to do is elect Hillary Clinton, that means that once again, possibly for 4 or 8 years, you're going to be quiet, and we're going to be in this thing by ourselves.
That's right. That's right.
So we say to people that we have to fight, and the only question for us is, who is going to fight with us?
That's right.
We're going to vote on Tuesday, but we're going to continue the struggle. We're not going to allow fear to guide our activity. We are going to be the ones to step out and to take history in our own hands. That is the essence of this campaign, this Power to the People campaign. We recognize that we have to shift power back to the people, that we have to be the ones to fight for this fragile democracy, that racial justice and economic justice are linked.
That's right.
We have to be the ones. So, my friends, it is an honor to be a part of this movement, and we are in fact a movement. It's been an honor to be a part of this party, this campaign, and it will be an honor for me to continue to struggle with you and to see you down the road as we transform this country and this world. Thank you.
Different issues and concerns. I'm finding so many different mentalities.